Okay, because we had... Oh, no, we're not going another 5 minutes. No, go ahead and take the countdown off. I know online they're going, hey, man, it's 10:32 and he hasn't started yet. What happened? It's because I had the wrong scripture up to go on the screen, so fortunately we've got Tammy working hard on it, and I think she's gotten that taken care of. Good morning! Welcome to New Life Community Church. My name is Pastor Mark. I'm the current pastor for one more week. This is just kind of crazy to me. We have moved out of the apartment over there because our new pastor that's coming for the beginning of July. July 1st is his first day. I think July 3rd will be his first Sunday here. Be sure to give him a great welcome as much as you can with what's going on. And even next Sunday being my last Sunday, you know, it's just I'll slowly fade away. So, we're still out on the river. So if you want to come and put a fishing line in, you're welcome to come. It's good to see y'all today. Good to have y'all here and worship. Those who are able to come, those who are joining with us on Facebook, thank you for joining with us. We do encourage people to register your attendance, but as we don't do that on the registration pads anymore right now because of precautions, we do ask that you do that online. And there are directions in your bulletin if you were able to download it or look at it, and that'll show you where to go on that. Also, sermons are available on Facebook or on YouTube. So if you happen to miss one, like this one, if you happen to go to sleep, if you happen to nod off or something, then you'll get a chance to catch up, and then you'll know everything that happened. But, we hope that you're able to come on that as well. Online giving is also another thing online. We do encourage you to give. The church is still going on. We still have the bills. We still got whatever utilities that we use. We're increasing as we increase the use of our building. So please be sure to give towards that, because it is giving to God. It's giving to the mission of the church and the other things that go towards mission in our church. So please do that. Looking at some of the announcements that are in the bulletin, there's a book study that's going to be on the book that recommended by Bishop Harvey entitled White Fragility, dealing with a lot of the issues that are going on today with Black Lives Matter. And we encourage you to take part in that, but it won't start until July 1st. And it is an online study on Zoom. But because the books are not in yet, I had to delay just a little bit. So that's going to start on July 1st. And then if you don't have enough books in your library, I have free books from my library. I have trimmed it down the final time, I think. And they are in the fellowship hall, the first Sunday school room to your left. And you'll need to get keys and so forth. Don't take any of the children's vacation Bible school materials or anything like that, please. I tried to cover that up. But I've got like some long tables full of books just to give away. And please take as many as you want. And we're going to it's going to be open on Tuesday and Wednesday from 10 to 2. And that's the times where Rebecca is. And we'll be here at least definitely all that time on Tuesday, maybe part of the time on Wednesday. So please wear a mask and practice social distancing. No fighting over the books, okay? Who fights over books these days? Oh, I would, but they're free. So please take as many as you can. Coming up tomorrow, Vacation Bible School. It's going to be weird to have Vacation Bible School started and no kids in the building. So it's all virtual Vacation Bible School. We are doing this along with partnering with Mount Zion Mary Baptist Church. And together we have 100 kids taking part in it. And I think that's as many packets as they had that were made. And so there are 100 kids signed up. But if yours did not sign up, you can still follow along along on some of the videos and activities that will be online. I think it will be, some of it will be on Facebook or online, so you can still take part in that. So thanks to all those who are working on that. I did some interesting videos. You look at it, you'll see why one of them just kind of really caught me off guard. So I'll let you give you a little tension in setting that up. One other thing is that we've got our Can I Get a Witness booklets. We did send them out to everyone online, and so if you got those, just go ahead and keep it there. We do just have a few extra hard copies. We try not to handle them at all, but they're on the back table so that you can take home and read if you'd like. Okay, there's another wire that I'm needing, apparently, because they're listening. Oh, man, I got to take this thing off again. All right.
Well, let's try to on the back side of your jacket.
All right. Well, So that was our introductory video for our Vacation Bible School. We were having some trouble with the wiring on the mics, and I think we got that straight, hopefully. Thank you, Wayne. And happy Father's Day to all the dads out there and in here. Happy Father's Day to y'all. This is always a special day, and I don't know if you're able to get family together now or not, or whether you trust them with the virus, but just as much as you can. Yeah, well, that's usually, I'm thinking in terms of my kids growing up and coming in, and sometimes it's not a big issue because they're still living with you. And sometimes if they're grown up, they're still living. Happy Father's Day to all those dads out there. Let's go to the Lord in spirit of prayer as we begin, and then we'll start singing. Lord, thank you for your great goodness and generosity. We pray that our worship is pleasing in your sight. In the name of Jesus, we pray it. Amen.
Faith of our fathers living still, in spite of dungeon fire and sword. Oh, how our hearts beat high with joy whene'er we hear that glorious word. Faith of our fathers, holy faith, we will be true to
please rise as we join together in the Apostles' Creed. But before we do that, Thank you to Ms. April Ebling for coming today. Beth Dupuy is up in Michigan somewhere visiting family. So thank you to April for being here with us today. Let's join together in this historic profession of our Christian faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated.
Stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am. Well, I've seen many searching for answers far and searching for answers, only you provide. We could know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. So undeniable, I can hardly speak. Peace so unexplainable, I can hardly think. As you call me, deeper still, as you call me, deeper still, as you call me. Father, it's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am.
At this time, we come to our time of prayer, and of course, we've got a lot of prayer concerns that are on the back sheet, and there are a lot of folks that we want to remember. And so, as I'm looking down the list, you know, I see folks like Sil, and how's he doing this morning? All right, doing okay, yeah. And so, we've got several other people that are there, and please take note of that. We want to pray for the Kings, and I know they're having some health issues right now, and many of you know about that. So let's go to the Lord in the spirit of prayer, and say the names of those that you want to remember. Our Heavenly Father, we ask that you would hear the names as their faces come to our mind. Their faces will be right there in your mind as well. And in fact, you'll be looking at them and you are with them right now where they are. And so, Lord, we ask for your grace as we say their names. Maritza Perez, Tom Howe, Andres. Jennifer. Pastor Mishy. So Lord, as we say their names and remember their faces, hear our prayer, we pray, and that you might bring healing and strength to them this day. We thank you for those, in fact, some that are here that have experienced your healing recently. So we praise you for that as well. Lord, today we ask you to bless our earthly fathers for the many times that they reflected the love and strength and generosity and wisdom and mercy that you exemplify in your relationship with us, your children. And so we honor our fathers for putting our needs above their own convenience and comfort, for teaching us how to show courage and determination in the face of adversity, for challenging us to move beyond self-limiting boundaries, for modeling the qualities that would turn us into responsible, principled, caring adults. And Lord, we know not all our fathers lived up to those ideals, and many of those of us who are praying right now have felt like we've not all lived up to those ideals. And so we ask for each of us, give us grace to acknowledge and learn from our mistakes. Give us the grace to extend the same forgiveness to them, those that may have failed us in some way, that you offer to us. Help us to resist the urge to stay stuck in past bitterness, instead moving forward with humility and peace of heart. We ask your blessing on those men who served as father figures in our lives as well, when our biological fathers weren't able to do it. May the love and selflessness that they showed us be returned to them in all their relationships, and help them to know that their influence has changed us for the better. Give new and future fathers the guidance that they need to raise happy and holy children, grounded in a love for God and other people. And remind these fathers that treating their wives with dignity, compassion, and respect is one of the greatest gifts that they can give their children. We pray that our fathers who have passed into the next life have been welcomed into your loving embrace, and that our family will be one day, reunited in your heavenly kingdom. So, Lord, we ask that you would hear our prayer as we join together in the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our scripture lesson, I must have put the wrong one in the planning center, but it is from the Gospel of Mark. Mark chapter 1, verse 16 through 20. Mark chapter 1, 16 through 20. And if you're able, please rise as we read from the Gospel this morning. As Jesus passed along the Galilee Sea, he saw two brothers, Simon and Andrew, throwing fish nets into the sea, for they were fishermen. "Come, follow me," he said, "and I'll show you how to fish for people." Right away, they left their nets and followed him. After going a little further, he saw James and John, Zebedee's sons, in their boat repairing the fishing nets. At that very moment, he called them, and they followed him, leaving their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired workers. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated.
I like to move and move it. I like to move and move it. I like to move and move it. We like to move it. I like to move and move it. She like to move and move it. He like to move and move it. We like to move it. I like to body body. He like to body body. They like to body body. We like to body. She like to shake it, shake it. She like to shake it, shake it. He like to shake it, yeah. Somebody say ho, say ho, ho. Back it up, back it up, back it up, back it up, back it up. Yo, somebody say yeah, say yeah, yeah. Back it up, 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 back it up. Give me room, give me room, give me room, car.
First name Moto, last name Moto. Here's how you spell it, M-O-T-O, M-O-T-O. When I step in, all the girls want a photo. You know, hey, you.
We like to party, party. We like to party, party. We like to party, party. We like to
party.
We like to move and move it. He like to move and move it. They like to move and move it. Move it, move it, move it, move it, move it.
Well, I had my back to you, so I don't know if y'all were standing up dancing around, and then you quickly sat down when I turned around again. But you almost want to do that. You got to move it. Let's go to the Lord in spirit of prayer. And now may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. You know, when you read this passage about Jesus calling the disciples, calling Peter and Andrew, James and John, these people that only knew fishing up to that point in their lives, and he says, follow me. The fact that they dropped everything and followed him is just amazing to us. I mean, we're trying to get, would I do something like that? It had to take a tremendous amount of faith. And some say that the disciples knew about Jesus for some time. They might have heard him preaching already. They might have seen some miracles that were being performed before this. And so that they may have known him as he preached about the kingdom of God a little bit. They knew about him a little bit already. Maybe that would make it a little bit more sense for them to take that first step. But you know, still, that's just kind of hard to believe. A few years ago, there was on a Sunday morning, I was talking with the senior pastor at the church where I was, at Pineville United Methodist, and me and Ricky and the DS were talking in the hallway during Sunday school. Probably we shouldn't have been, but a couple of the youth came out. Of course, I thought they were going to tell us, would you please be quiet, but instead they came out and asked us a question that made us really stop and think. You know, they said they needed to come up with a skit about being called by Jesus today. What would he say, or would we drop everything and follow him? And so what kind of scenario would you come up with? You know, if Jesus were to call someone today like that, what would you do if Jesus showed up, you know, at your workplace and said, follow me? Or during your prayer time, you know, you were talking to him, and then if he showed up, we would be really scared. But But if he would show up during your prayer time and say, "Follow me," and you'd feel it very strongly. Or at school, and Jesus said, "Follow me." Would we take that first step moving forward and leave everything behind to follow Jesus? You know, the Bible says that Jesus called a lot of people. He called a lot of others, not just these 12 that responded. But many came up with excuses. You know, one wanted to wait until his elderly parents passed away before he would follow Jesus. Well, Jesus didn't have that much time. One didn't want to leave all that he had, and he walked away sadly. Another wanted to have, a big party, big going away party, but Jesus said, "There's no time for that." And so they didn't follow. None of them took that step to follow Jesus. And for those who did step forward and move out of their comfort zone, for those who did, the world was never the same again. The world changed because those few people followed Jesus. So imagine everything that the disciples saw and heard when they followed Jesus. I mean, they were the inner circle. They saw everything, heard everything, and they followed him, even after his resurrection, and they followed him all over the world. And you read the stories, the legends about the disciples, about where they were. You know, I imagine that there were people that when they would sit around and listen, they would just be fascinated with these stories. It would be sort of like, in my strange mind, it made me think of beer commercials. About the most interesting man in the world.
People hang on his every word, even the prepositions. He could disarm you with his looks or his hands. Either way, he can speak French in Russian. He is the most interesting man. He has inside jokes with complete strangers. Cuba imports cigars from him. Mosquitoes refuse to bite him, purely out of respect. He is the most interesting man in the world.
I know it's kind of silly, but it just made me think of you know, to have an interesting life. So how's your life going? Is it interesting? You know, would you be able to tell stories? Or are we stuck in our comfort zone? What kind of faith stories would you tell? The stories about the times when you followed Christ into something that scared the daylights out of you, but you went anyway. The times where it took faith because you didn't know how it was going to turn out. The times of healings, the times of God's grace. You know, what kind of stories would you tell about following Christ? Only those who leave their comfort zones will have great stories. The rest will just sit around and listen, go home and do nothing, and wonder why their life is so boring. It takes faith and courage to move forward. There was a movie a while back called We Bought a Zoo. Maybe you've seen that. I love that, the movie. It's based on a true story of a widower who's trying to make a new life with his children. Well, he's looking for a house where they can all be comfortable, and they find the perfect house. The only problem with it is you can buy the house, but it comes with a zoo. And so they struggle with it, and much to their own surprise, they took a huge step. They bought the house and the zoo, although they knew nothing about running a zoo. Well, Matt Damon plays the dad who, in this scene that we're going to show, is encouraging his son to take a scary step out of his comfort zone to talk to the girl that he likes.
What happened with you and Lily?
I don't know. I guess I didn't listen to something she told me or something. I mean, I liked her. It's like you embarrass yourself if you say something, and you embarrass yourself if you don't.
You know, sometimes all you need is 20 seconds of insane courage. Just literally 20 seconds of just embarrassing bravery. And I promise you, something great will come of it.
Seconds of embarrassing, brave courage. 20 seconds. You know, a few years ago, our bishop, Bishop Cynthia Harvey, used this clip in her message to the churches and all the United Methodist churches represented there and all the pastors represented there. And she challenged us all to move forward, to move when it comes to taking those 20 outrageous courage. And she did that to become a bishop. So make the step to move forward and see what happens. See if it, you know, when you're feeling that uncertainty, just take the leap. Just go for it and see what you might say of insane courage. Who knows what will happen as long as you're following the call of Jesus. Now, moving forward doesn't always mean immediate success that comes next. You know, we think, oh, if I step out for Jesus, it's all going to be good. Well, remember what happened to the disciples. So we can know that we're going to fall. But when you fall, it's not if, when you fall, fall forward. And that way you're moving forward still. You get up and you go, and maybe you'll fall forward again. It'll still move you ahead a little more. Now, sometimes it's two steps forward and one step back, but you're still moving forward. Now, moving forward and following Jesus can also be terrifying because you are not in control. And a lot of us kind of like to be in control. You know, we plan things out. We want to make sure we understand what the outcome is going to be. But there's no guarantee that it's going to turn out like you planned. But you go anyway. I remember when I first learned to snow ski. You know, I took all the lessons on the bunny hills, and I did like everybody else does. You know, you're almost like a bowling ball going down to the end of the bunny hill. As they're trying to get up, you go and knock down everybody else that's trying to get up. I've heard of some people who are injured at the bottom of the bunny hill because of that before. But I did all of that, you know, and I was struggling along, and I learned how to stop, so that was important. Stopping when you're skiing is really important. Then finally, I learned enough to get on the ski lift. Now, that's a terrifying thing. The ride is fine. It's knowing that you had to get off and slide down the little slope to go where you're supposed to go and get out of everybody's way. So I mastered that. That was okay. I made it up on top of the bunny or the beginner slope. This was past the bunny slope now. This is the beginner slope. And at the beginner slope, when you're beginning, it is like you are on top of the mountain. Because I remember standing on the edge of that slope thinking, this is crazy. I got two pieces of wood that are waxed attached to my feet, and I'm about to slide down an icy mountain. Whose idea was this anyway? You know, what am I thinking? This has to be crazy. But you know, there I was. I took the lessons. So I pushed off. I fell a lot. It took a while to get down the hill, but I kept getting up and tried to use the lessons that I learned and to adapt and to learn. And eventually, you know, I learned and I experienced the exhilarating rush of the cool wind on my face and the challenge of learning something new and the joy of reaching the bottom of the slope, knowing that I survived and everybody else around me did. And then looking back up the mountain that I had conquered and said, let's do that again. That's crazy. Jesus will always lead you to the edge of that mountain and say, follow me. And it's terrifying sometimes. You know, it's interesting. I don't know if y'all believe in coincidences at all. I kind of call them God incidences sometimes. Well, about a week ago, I was reading April's podcast. April's got a podcast, and I'm reading about the directions to it, and so the introduction really captured my attention, so I was listening to her podcast, and it was about her first experience with prison ministry. It's like the one that I went to a few months ago, and she was well-trained. They train you very well, spend a lot of time with the training, and prepare you as much as possible and before you go in. It's to follow where Christ is leading you, for her to follow where Christ was leading her, to minister through music at a women's prison. And so you might want to listen to her story. Here's an advertisement, free advertising this morning. AprilSingsALot.com. You can go there and listen to the story and several others that she has. But as I listened to this, you know, I realized that, you know, you just have to take a step forward. And it may be scary at first. You take that risk into the unknown. And for her, she took that risk into the unknown that led you to at least two other times back to the prison again. And I have no doubt she made a difference for Christ in that place and touching those women's lives. And I guarantee you those women touched your lives as well. So that we're changed by the people that we minister to. So where is Jesus leading you? You know, right now we're just kind of, we feel like we're stuck. But this coronavirus hiding away is not going to last forever. And there's things that people are hurting now, maybe more so because of this now. So what do we do? How do we follow Jesus in this time? You know, it may be in preparation for being a volunteer as a CASA advocate. You touch the life of a child or a youth who's going through a difficult time in their life. It might be going out to serve or deliver food or clothing or sleeping mats to the homeless. You know they have names. You know they have stories. There are a lot of people who will deliver the stuff and just say, God bless you, and that's it. But not a lot of people who will stop and listen to their stories. And when you stop and listen, you're blessed by them and by the way that God is with them. And you are blessing mainly because you cared about them as human beings. It might be through a phone ministry with the need for social distancing, where you can check up on people where you're not able to go see them yet, or people on the prayer list, and to actually have a brief prayer with them. Don't make it just where it's just the same as a social call. That may be the most awkward part for you, but just to say a brief prayer, make it a ministry where you're sharing Christ with them. It might be a ministry where, like the card ministry that we've got, or if it may be, even though you can't go in there physically yourself, giving to a ministry. It might be a foreign mission, whether it's supporting the McCormicks, the missionaries, the McCormicks, or the Martini family that came and visited us, a big family from Guatemala and all that they're doing there. They can use your support. Or missionaries of church, like we started doing with the church in Emmaus, Cuba, down in the Guantanamo area, far away from any help. And you can make a difference. And when we're finally able to go back to any of these places, foreign or domestic, touch the eyes of others as a Christ follower. Remember, you know, as I've said many times before, you've heard me say it, if you're following Christ, you have to be moving. If you're not moving, you're not following. You're just sitting there. So if we're following Christ, it means we're moving forward, going through those scary times. You know, I faced a scary time of decision several years ago. It was at the end of 2004. Maybe you remember me sharing this other times. I was a senior pastor of a large church, and I was just burnt out. I led the church through 3 capital fund drives, 2 building programs. We tore down old parts of the church that were leaky and smelled of mildew, but they had a lot of emotional attachment to people. We built a new educational building and a beautiful fellowship wing. I was preaching 3 services a Sunday. The first was a traditional service at 8:30, then a contemporary service at 9:45. And we had it in the sanctuary, so we had to put up the screen, put the projector out, get the instrument all out, and then at the end of that service, take it all down because the 11 o'clock service was coming in, and they didn't like that screen. So we had to take all that down and be ready for the next one. And then, of course, you know, with the contemporary service, my worship leader quit. So that meant I was doing the 3 services and I was leading the worship band. So I was worn out. And there were all the administrative issues and staff issues of a larger church. And I knew my next move was most likely to be more of the same. And I was going, oh, no. I knew I was going to be miserable. And I was already miserable at that time. And but, you know, it was not much to look forward to. And so I saw some of my older friends, my older minister friends who had retired. And they were excited about retirement because they said, now I can focus on the area of ministry that I have always loved and where I was energized the most. And I started looking at them and I thought, why do I have to wait till retirement? So at the beginning of 2005, this is 15 years ago, Bishop Hutchinson allowed me to take a three-month sabbatical leave. That's where another pastor would come in and preach during those 3 months that I was out and lead the church as I rested and studied and renewed. And I remember I slept for 2 weeks. Then Jesus and I started getting reacquainted. Because, you know, you can be the head of a church and still get further away from Jesus because you just get caught up in the business of stuff. And so Jesus and I got reacquainted. I went on a men's silent retreat where I began to reevaluate my call to ministry. And the Lord gave me a new call. It's like a call within the call. There was the big call to ministry, but there's also calls within the call. And I was concerned about the young adults who are graduating from high school and disappearing from church. You know, how can we reach them for Christ? So a major part of that new call was to start with a ministry emphasis on contemporary worship. So I went from, you know, mostly traditional and some contemporary to all contemporary. So I was appointed as the associate pastor then at Broadmoor United Methodist Church in charge of a service called The River. Because, you know, whenever you do these contemporary services, we like catchy names. And it's called The River. And enjoyed that time very much. You know, I remember that when he told me about this, he said, you know, this is going to mean a smaller salary. Yeah, I know. It's going to mean changing your career path. Yeah, I know. I mean moving forward into an unknown territory, unfamiliar. And Rhonda saw what was happening to me before this, and she was very supportive and ready for any change that was going to give me peace. Nothing like being miserable at home too, and that's what happens. You know, so together we took that big step forward. Some of my colleagues thought I was taking a step backward. They thought I was being demoted for some reason. You know, well, you're getting this cut in salary. What did you do wrong? That was really what they were thinking at first. I didn't do anything wrong. I was just looking at this new call. And so we took that step. And so looking back over those 15, 16 years, it's been great. And this has been our last step. Our last step in that journey of this particular calling, this second calling. And now it's time for Ron and I to take another step as we step into retirement from the pastoral ministry and discover what is the new thing that God has in store for us. And we talk about it, we play with the ideas all the time. You know, my call to ministry still burns in my heart. I can't escape it. I can't escape it. I don't really want to escape it. Now, I might not have a church for retirement, but as John Wesley said, the world is my parish, so wherever he will lead me. And I suspect the first part of retirement maybe will be like the sabbatical. You know, I'll sleep a couple of weeks or just relax. But then we had this coronavirus thing, and I could sleep a lot more as it is. So, you know, so it's almost having the pre-retirement time and saying, okay, get ready now because you've had your rest. But I could invest more time with Rhonda, and with our children and our grandchildren and great-grandson, and rediscover a new call within my call ministry. So where is Jesus calling you to move forward in life? He's calling you out of the boredom of your comfort zone to follow him. And he might be calling you into some area of ministry. Maybe he's calling you into foreign mission field in some way, if you can't go to support it in some way and make such a huge difference in the world. Maybe he's calling you into the mission field of Luling. There is a lot to do out here. A lot of hurt, a lot of need. He's calling you to be a disciple. And so Jesus says, come, follow me, follow me. Let's go. It's time. What are you waiting for? You might be afraid to move forward, but just take 20 seconds of insane courage and move forward. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Lord, there are times when we think, well, that's it. And something changes in our life and we flounder a little bit. But Lord, your call is constant on our lives. Jesus calls people of all ages. We are able to do some things that other people can't do. Some of it's active. Some of it's right where we are. Some of it's where we're still concerned about this virus, but there's still things that we can do to make a difference to people in our community. We're doing that with Vacation Bible School. Thank you, Lord, for the privilege that we have of doing that. We ask your blessing upon those who participate in it, that it may change the spiritual atmosphere of our communities. And so, Lord, we ask that your grace would be upon us now as we go to you and listen. And when we hear you call, follow. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. As I mentioned earlier, there's a way that we respond often, and that's through the giving of our tithes and offerings. We are not passing the plate around. If you would like, you can come down. We're going to, April, if we'll just start playing the instrumental part of this song, and we invite you to come down if you would like to place your offering here, back, or you can place it in the offering plate when you leave here. You're able.
I'm gonna sing
when the Spirit says sing. I'm gonna sing when the Spirit says sing. I'm gonna sing when the Spirit says sing and obey the Spirit of the Lord. I'm gonna pray. I'm gonna pray when the Spirit says pray. I'm gonna pray when the Spirit says pray. I'm gonna pray when the Spirit says pray and obey the Spirit of the Lord. Move! I'm gonna move
when the Spirit says
move. I'm gonna move when the Spirit says move. I'm gonna move when the Spirit says move and obey the Spirit of the Lord. I'm gonna go! I'm gonna go when the Spirit says go. Gonna go when the Spirit says go. I'm gonna go when the Spirit says go and obey the Spirit of the Lord.
Can I get an amen? Amen. All right. Well, let's receive the benediction as we close our time today. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. God bless you. God bless y'all who have joined us on Facebook.